Shalit. So today we're very happy to have Andre Pranav visiting us from Simon Fraser University. So Andre got his PhD at the University of Alberta and then spent some time here at CETA and at Stanford University before moving to his present position at Simon Fraser University. And his research interests are very diverse. They cover cosmology, inflation, general relativity, and many other exciting topics. Today he's going to tell us something about modeling polarized programs.
Great, thank you. Thanks for the invitation, and it's always nice to be here. I try to come whenever I have the chance, but. All right, so what I'm going to talk about is the stuff we have been doing, and it sort of was a slippery slope. You start out doing cosmology, primordial universe, and then you sort of maybe I should compare it with observational data, and then you start comparing it with observational data, and then you realize, okay, there is this astrophysical foreground things, and all of a sudden I'm doing dust. Well, anyway, that's pretty much how it went. So I will talk a little bit more about the inflation theory side of it, but I'll spend most of the time talking about the practical matters. What is sort of the foregrounds, you're looking for and battling when you do the CMB. So you're not getting to look, you're not basically looking at the CMB only, and there is other stuff on the sky. Well, so this was sort of, the slippery slope went by me getting drafted into the Planck. So we wanted to take a look at the how reheating modes would get imprinted into the CMB. And here's the Planck actual, satellite before the launch. And this is a space satellite, which has basically a bunch of detectors in the focal plane. They're all microwave, part of it bolometer, part of it is radio frequency detectors. But essentially, this is stuff we're talking about. So we basically have handful of pixels here on the sky. When we talk about the next generation stuff that's coming up from the ground and the stuff which is already on the ground, we're talking about thousands of detectors in one optical tube, or maybe 10,000 detectors, right? So the signal to noise would be quite a bit bigger in a lot of the new generation detectors. So what used to be just happily hidden inside the noise and you don't have to worry about it, you'll have to worry about it. All right, I'll skip that one. So the results of the CMB you've probably seen already many times, and that's a map people usually show it to you. It's actually a smoothed down map. Actual map is about 50 megapixels. There is no way to squeeze it into 1 megapixel projector, unless I do zoom on it. And the thing that jumps at you right away when you look at this map is basically the correlation length of about 1 degree on it. That's the first acoustic peak in the CMB spectrum that basically gets you the size of the blob. That's a characteristic size of the CMB structure that you have on the sky. And not only you measure the temperature, these things are essentially just differences in gravitational potential when the photons climb out, when the media gets recombination done. So essentially, apart from variety of transfer functions applied to it, it's literally the picture of the gravitational potential at about 400,000 years after the Big Bang. So in some sense, it's a nice picture to have. So you have the primordial physics imprint and the where these fluctuations are coming from. Well, nowadays, people are reasonably certain that these are quantum fluctuations from inflation. So the evidence for it is not ironclad yet. And one of the things that you might want to do is also detect primordial gravitational waves. So if you have the photons, which just climb out of the potential well, temperature fluctuations is the stuff you get, but you don't just get that. You have the plasma which sloshes around in the potential, and it doesn't do it in spherically symmetric fashion. So you have two directions locally where the plasma will go more to this way. So it produces linear polarization for the photons. That you can also measure. And this is created by two things. Polarization patterns would be created by the sloshing of the stuff in gravitational potential, which is random. That creates essentially gradient-like pattern in polarization. And then you would have something like gravitational waves, which are local quadrupole changes in the space-time. So they also create the pattern of polarization, but it is curl-like. So it basically has curly, swirly pattern on the polarization things. We haven't seen the B-modes. If you see the B-modes, it was going to be really good for primordial universe knowledge, because scalar fluctuations are kind of degenerate on what the inflationary field is doing. But gravitational field, like gravitational, primordial gravitational waves, they just feel what the expansion rate of the universe is. So you could tell when inflation was happening, at which energy scales, if you break the degeneracy. That's essentially one of the motivations you want to go after these guys. Anyway, so we have the picture of this. So one of the things you notice if you're actually paying attention to the color bar, that this is like, you know, 300 microkelvin in anisotropy. This one is like 3 microkelvin anisotropy. So polarization you get is pretty much smaller than the temperature anisotropy signal you're getting it. And most of it is just due to the gravitational potential. So all of it is this gradient or E mode. So if you're talking about small amount of gravitational waves on top of it, there would be a pattern which is quite a bit smaller than that, somewhere hiding in there, and you have to find it. Okay, so how much of this you do expect? This is like a mega figure people like to quote and show on conferences. It's not quite as mega as it might be, but it has like, you know, quite a few of the favorite inflation models of people and constraints from a variety of data sources. TT, TE, and EE stands for temperature, E mode, and E mode spectra from Planck. And then there is low E likelihood and the Lenzing constraints as well. BK14 is a Bicep Keck 2014 paper, and BAO stands for baryon acoustic oscillations. Anyway, the takeaway message that there is basically a few favorite models of inflation. This was my favorite model of inflation for a long time. It still is. And it predicts two things. It predicts, if you knew what M or coefficient in front of it was, you would know the amplitude of the fluctuations. But of course you don't. So you cannot say you predicted the amplitude of fluctuations. What you can do with this model is take like an amplitude fluctuations you see and fit it to parameters of the model. And then you would know essentially how fast it ramps down, because, you know, potential is kind of quadratic. You sort of go down this potential thing. So the amplitude of the fluctuations you get sort of decreases as you go down. So that's parameterized by the tilt of the primordial spectrum of the fluctuation. So you normally get something like a power law fit in that, but you don't have to. And ET is going to have larger amplitude on bigger scales than on smaller scales. And most of the models of inflation where you sort of crawl down the potential will predict it somewhat less than one. So a lot of these guys end up being like, you know, a point on this diagram. And the point has a tail associated with this simply because we don't know how much universe expanded after the end of inflation. We don't know equation of state of it that well. So that amount of, you know, expansion could easily be like, you know, e to the power of 10-ish. And that basically shifts amplitudes a little bit and tilts when you take a look at it. So anyway, looking at this diagram, it seems clear that the data wants to sit somewhere in this ellipse. So one of the things you on this axis is the tilt of the primordial spectrum. So it's not equal to one. So there's clearly some evolution during inflation, which we get to see. And the second axis of it, which is interesting one, is the ratio between tensor and scalar fluctuations. So that's a ratio essentially between gravitational wave fluctuations you get and the scalar or gravitational potential fluctuations normalized with a certain constant and certain scale, which I won't go into it. But this thing is not even one, so it's not even close to one. It's basically, even by current data, it is constrained to be sort of, you know, 0.05-ish at most, which basically means whatever this gravitational wave fluctuations amplitude is, it's pretty small. So it's factor of 20 at least smaller than the scalar type fluctuations we are looking at. So it's going to be pretty hard to find. Despite this being a hard job, it might be possible, and there is a bunch of models of inflation. Yes?
I just want to make sure I'm interpreting this plot correctly. Mm-hmm. So for all of the different observational constraints, the shaded areas or what they're constrained, the different inflation models, should I just understand, I guess, between these two points that are representing there, that sort of, if you vary that, it should lie somewhere along that line between those two points?
Yep. And if you look at this, like there is like these things like alpha attractors, which has a way of parametrically tune down the amplitude and the scale essentially as low as you want by essentially flattening up the potential. You don't get to see much of the potential, right? So it might be starting out like that, but it might be actually flattening up. And these alpha attractor models will just flatten effective potential by essentially coupling the motion of the inflaton to gravity in a non-trivial way. So anyway, there is more models of inflation than inflationary physicists, because most of them have at least like, you know, N papers about it. So that's a quite a compressed summary of what it is. It just has monomial potential. And one of the curious ones is R square inflation. That's original Starobinsky paper before inflation was even inflation. And that one actually ironically sits in this, like, you know, right smack in the middle of the confidence ellipse. So that would be like the greatest cosmic irony ever if, like, you know, you write the first paper ever and like guess it. Well, I would be cheering for that outcome. I was really literally cheering for this one, but now it's sort of, you know, disfavored at, like, you know, couple of sigma level. But anyway, it's hard to put theoretical prior on what the model of inflation has to be right, or rather, I'll rephrase it. Every inflationary cosmologist has his own prior on it, and it's usually delta function. Like, you know, this is like, you know, my inflation model, therefore it's right. But anyway, as far as observations go, like, you know, that looks like we still have a lot of, like, you know, parameter space to go to actually nail down to some of these models. You know, you have to go down by a factor of 5 of the current upper bounds to, like, you know, basically see this guy, R square thing. But the temperature spectra and E mode is actually nailed right now by the observations. You don't even have to put the model in. What you can do is you can just put any primordial spectrum you like a spline. Primordial tilt is basically you get a power law spectrum, so it is slightly evolving in time. So things which are bigger on scale and got out earlier would be slightly higher in amplitude. So that tilt is basically the spectrum, like, you know, power law exponent which parameterizes this. It's perhaps is easier if I just show you the next slide and tell you what it is. So here it is. Here's the scale, like physical scale, of the modes you're looking at. And you would say, well, let's say I have a primordial power spectrum of the fluctuations, whatever it might be. Might be a straight line, might be a tilted line. This is logarithm, so this straight line would be a power law. Or maybe it's just like, you know, an arbitrary function, which is like really complicated. So let's say it's really arbitrary function, like, you know, spline it up with like whatever, 12 nodes, given arbitrary amplitudes. You put it in the Markov chain Monte Carlo constraining, you know, with likelihood that the data actually sees. It totally nails it down to a straight line in a fairly large range of observations. And of course you have like, you know, a bunch of like, you know, flex where you have fairly sizable amount of noise. And then you have fairly sizable amount of flex in the places where you don't have enough modes. So you just have like, you know, one draw for like a, like, you know, monopole and like, you know, dipole modes, so they're not very well constrained. So, and that black line is a power law. It is ever so slightly tilted. If you look at it, it's not horizontal, and that's because of this. I don't have to impose any model in, like, you know, like M square, phi square model fits really well, but you know, I don't have to impose any model. The data that you have right now, it just nails all of it to a straight line where you don't have like, you know, cosmic variance or noise domination. It's actually not trivial amount of, you know, it's two orders of magnitude essentially in K-space. So that seems like a pretty straight line. And it's even more impressive than that. This is used as the temperature data. You know, polarization of the cosmic microwave background came about, like, you know, during my memory, like, you know, I was at CETA at the time when, like, you know, the first things got, like, you know, this is like big arrow bar cross thing appeared, and all of a sudden it's not arrow bar cross thing anymore.
Can we just go back just to make a quick comment? Mm-hmm. M squared phi squared for tensor to scalar is also that psi n line below, which is so egregiously off the current data that in the final version of this figure for the Planck inflation paper, they said, we must take this off figure.
So people don't laugh at us.
that is in some sense any preferred model. And what's amazing is that the current limit on R is such that that's long gone, right, as being an allowed thing. The curious thing is that the slope turns out to be what the m squared phi squared would like, but for other reasons, presumably, and that is the slope of the phenomenology. Anyway, that's just sort of an update on this figure. There is no m squared phi squared model of BR, m squared phi squared model of BT in the final version.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I pulled this out from revision control. Anyway, so it's even like, you know, more striking than that now. So if you junk all the temperature data and just look at polarization maps only, it still nails it down to a straight line, except with a little bit like more on noise on offset, like onset, it comes in earlier. But it still, like, you know, nails it to a straight line. So there is like, no matter how you slice it or dice it, if you look at the either temperature, so gravitational potential directly, or polarization, which is sloshing around in the same gravitational potential, if that's nailed down to be essentially a power law-like, slightly not scale invariant, scale spectrum of primordial fluctuation. So starts looking like inflation. The question is, can we get the B mode, and then it would be unambiguous. Like, you know, if you have two of them nailed down, that would be really hard to argue, like, that it's anything else by inflation. I'm sure people will try, but okay. So essentially, the summary of inflationary, like theory part of it, it looks like temperature modes are nailed down even now. So we're going to have improvements on, like, you know, measurements of parameters. But the target now is literally like the B mode, these curly ones. And they're called B because, like, you know, it's magnetic field B, which is unfortunate because the rest of the talk I'm going to talk about the magnetic field, which is B. All right. So what about it? Well, that is actually hard. And the story why it's hard is, well, perhaps I should start from temperature before I go into it. The reason why it's hard is basically because you don't look at CMB and CMB only, right? You know, you don't get to have a clean window. Your window is always splattered with the stuff in front of you. So, and some of it is actually really, really bright. And it's local stuff in our galaxy that comes at you and shines at you. There is lots and lots and lots of sources which just produce emission in temperature channels. So intensity channels, to be more precise. And the way you tell them from CMB is essentially by color. CMB is black body. So it has, like, if you plot it in, like, you know, black body temperature units, it should be, like, you know, flat spectrum with the exponential cutoff being, like, you know, Planck spectrum, like turnaround. Other things are different in color. For example, if you have thermal dust, which is small grains of stuff floating up there, they are hotter than CMB, like maybe up to 30 Kelvin or something like that. And they're small, so they get modified by black body spectrum, by power law. So they rise up in emission with frequency. You know, there is synchrotron, which everybody knows and loves. If you have magnetic field, you know, things gyrate. When you gyrate, you accelerate it. So you get hit with these pulses coming at you, like integrated along all the electrons, that's, like positrons, they do this. This one depends on the distribution of these guys in energy. And if you look on the sky, it's very, very sort of reddish. So most of the power of it in low frequencies. There is also in temperature quite a few other components, including, like, you know, free emission. That's basically electron scattering on like on electrons. And then you get lines, like, you know, transition lines, like CO lines and stuff like that. So it's a sort of a mess. And when you look at the CMB, you realize, like, your sum of the foregrounds is about the same as your CMB in your most favorite window in frequency. Foregrounds are not like distributed uniformly on the sky. Most of the, like, galactic stuff is, of course, on the galactic plane. So if you go off galactic latitude, then you are, like, you know, looking fairly well at the CMB signal, but, like, you know, the spectrum is non-trivially, like, contaminated. So it's okay for the CMB temperature. If you go with something like 100 gigahertz, like MAP, it's mostly CMB, like, you know, as long as you don't look at where the galactic stuff is. So you can just mask it and sort of do it like that. But it gets worse when you look at the polarization. So most of the stuff that is in the intensity is not strongly polarized, but two of them are polarized, and one of them, like, everybody knew that it was polarized, and the other one was a surprise. Everybody knows that synchrotron is polarized because you go around on a plane, essentially, right? So there is a preferred direction. But thermal dust turned out to be quite a bit more polarized than people thought. It's about 20% polarization fraction as opposed to a few percent level. And the hope was you can actually find the window on the sky, maybe in high galactic latitude, where there won't be much of these guys around, and you can just cleanly get the CMB polarization and be done with this. But didn't pan out, so it looks like there's going to be no clean sync detection for free. So you'll have to work for it, or somebody will have to work for it. Yes.
My curiosity is that polarization for thermal dust. So that's just coming from the galactic plane. Does that have to do with bird orientations, so say charged things that light up the magnetic field, or anything?
Yeah, it's. I was about actually to go into it. Essentially, what happens with these things? Apparently, they they're not spherical grains, right? And they get aligned themselves to the magnetic field. And by the looks of it, they get aligned in the bulk, so they don't get perturbed often enough to get themselves randomized. So there is not a lot of this stuff out there. The column density is actually sort of tiny in counts, but they're fairly bright, and and they're bright at the frequencies we're looking at. So that's the problem with that. It is actually probably more complicated than that, because it's not likely there is just one species of dust floating around. So there's different things which might be out there, and you don't get to see their separation, you just integrate along the line of sight. So there might be one dust cloud, another dust cloud, and observationally we just get the total integral along the line of sight. And you're not even sure that the spectral, index of this is constant on the sky. It might be different, so it's black body. Temperature might be different in different places for sure, but also the modulation of the in front of it actually might also be different. So that's problematic. Mm-hmm. F sky is basically as I said, that this stuff is not uniformly distributed in the sky, right? So the simplest thing people do is just mask out part of the sky which is bright in the foreground, right? Take out the galactic plane. And this is just admittance of the mask. You take 83% of the sky remaining. If you go to the 30% cap, essentially looking at high latitude, foreground goes down, right? So that's why it's there, it's a band. So it doesn't go down to zero, that's the problem, right? Okay, so if you go do it from the ground, there is additional trouble that you have to deal with. It's atmospheric transmission is cutting you off from the high frequencies. You really want to know, if you really want to see dust, you want to go to higher frequencies possible. 300, 1000 gigahertz is even better. It's it's brightest there. So on the other hand, if you look through atmosphere and there is even 1 millimeter of water in above you, then you're screwed. It's also time variable screwed, because this stuff blows on top of you and you'll have to subtract it. So in some sense, it will say it will serve as 1/f noise. So when people try to do experimental detection strategies to minimize this thing. So for example, to go after polarization, all of the Simons observatory tubes are rotating quarter wave plate. So you get polarization from demodulation of that rotation frequency. So it's very good for rejecting long-term modulations of the things. But for intensity, for example, you would have to worry about this. So I'm sure they will be instrumented some sort of atmospheric transmission detectors above the observatory and stuff like that. But somebody will have to worry about it, and hopefully not me, because it's complicated. But anyway, there are a few windows you can easily hit at about 100 something and 270. And you can also go for low frequency, because you need to low frequency to see the synchrotron. Okay. But that's quite a bit lower, yeah. So in fact, you probably cannot do very high resolution synchrotron with anything but big dish, radio telescope, because most of the mirrors, SO is going to have a mix of large mirror, which is high resolution and low frequency things, and like, you know, their normal optical tubes for 100 gigahertz would be like, you know, this size, like, you know, half a meter or something like that. That's not good if you go to like 1 megahertz or something. Okay. So when all is said and done, like, you know, what people do, they do the component separation. Component separation is a name for just trying to figure out all of these colored components in their own bins. There are a few ways of doing it. One of the simplest conceptually is just make a linear combination and adjust the coefficients in this linear combination of all the channels you have so that you maximize your cosmic microwave background component and minimize everything else. These are known as, by a variety of names, internal linear combination, best linear unbiased estimator, or whatever. So these things would just sort of combine all the maps and do constraint optimization of the coefficients to minimize RMS of everything, like noise, all the foregrounds, subject to the constraint that the amplitude of the CMB is constant. So these things work quite well, and you can like split them into like wavelets or like in harmonic space. And the second more expensive way to go is for every pixel, just do the Gibbs sampling and do like, you know, estimate what the probability distribution of all of your parameters of the model you put in. This is like something like Commander does it. And that's a separation from 2015 Commander maps I have. That also picks up a bunch of transitional lines, which are detected by essentially band pass mismatch. What the detectors have, they have these filters in front of them, but they are sort of squarish, but not exactly. They have a little bit of like, you know, fluctuations between the different pixels. And if you take the difference between two things, you have like really high pass comp, which actually can pick up the line. So that's how these guys got made. All right. So, but let's get back to polarization story. So there are, as I said, there is two main components which are like foregrounds for us. It's synchrotron and dust. So amplitude of CMB polarization, even in E mode, is comparable or less. So even when you look at it, you have to do the component separation. And big surprise from Planck is dust emission is highly polarized, more highly polarized than like people thought. So basically, that are your enemies. You basically better know them if you want to fight them. And that's how they look like. That's total polarization patterns in synchrotron intensity. Sorry, not it's intensity component, but it's total polarized component, right? So it is highly localized in the galactic plane. But as you can see, nothing is ever simple when, like, you know, real physics is involved. There is, like, you know, spurs and stuff coming out. And the density contrast on this map is huge. So the brightest parts in the center of the galaxy is like basically 300 microkelvin in brightness temperature. We are talking about like, you know, 3 microkelvin tops in the E mode. And like, if I'm going to do like 1/100 of that, well, that's basically marching down to like sort of nanokelvin level. So this is got you got to get out of. And
what's the name of that nice feather there?
I got no, I call it the big arc.
Spur.
Or the big spur.
It's the North Pole spur. And does one see it as clear? I mean, the dust pictures you show have the same thing, but it shows up as clearly in the dust?
Not nearly as clearly. It is here.
Yeah. Other things.
Yeah. So I don't know. I'm really not an astronomer, despite being like, you know, associated with astronomers and astrophysics for like quite a long time. So I don't know how things are properly called or where they're located. So in some sense, I like call it as an advantage. I'm doing a truly blind analysis of this map because I don't know where the things are supposed to be.
But is the structure supposed to be close to this?
Yeah. Yes, but it's like, and they're probably not from the same place either, because like one is traced by like, you know, the dust grains, the other one electrons. So who knows? I mean.
But it shows up in the line reconstruction of the magnetic.
Yes, you're jumping ahead. Yes, but yes.
So I was looking at Martin Twan.
Yes. So here's the thing. You don't just get intensity information. In polarization, you also have direction. So it would be nice to visualize it. And Marc Antoine came from a nice idea to visualize it, just, you know, smear the noise along the direction of you want to visualize, like polarization. And then you'll end up with, like, you know, the smeared pattern overlaid on top of whatever else you want to see. So this is total intensity. And it's now has overlaid structures which have been smeared in the direction of where polarization is pointing. So you see this, like, huge spur thing. It essentially has coherent structure associated with this almost in the same direction and continues on and goes over all over this place. So it looks like, you know, there is huge correlation length in a lot of the polarization structures. That's synchrotron. And if I go to dust and do the same trick, it becomes more swirlier because, like, you know, you have more resolution on the map. But it's still there. Here is, like, you know, your spur, and here is the stuff that's tracing it out. So if you look at these swirly patterns, they become like more correlated than intensity patterns. It's probably trying to tell you something that, you know, what is the polarization of synchrotron tracing? Well, for sure, direction of the magnetic field. What is the polarization of dust tracing? Well, probably also magnetic field, because, like, what is a dust grain? It's essentially a compass needle, and you have like a bunch of them, like, you know, just above you, and you know what happens when you have a bunch of compass needles. They just trace the magnetic field line. All right. So, unfortunately for everybody, the cleanest field, like on the sky, like a bicep 2 field, is full of this coherent stuff through it, and there is still intensity of emission in there. So, what, like, you know, there is no literally, like, you know, nobody actually, like, you know, did a, like, clean up the window in one particular place for us to look through. So it's just dirty. Okay, so I'll skip the stacking. That's one of the ways, how I'm doing for time. Yeah, I should probably skip the stacking, yes. So there is ways to basically, like, you know, try to do statistical estimates of how the statistics of the maps looks like and try to extract it. It's not as simple anymore as a power spectrum because it's non-Gaussian ones. But let's get to the sort of beef of the subject. Can we even model these polarized dust emissions? I've shown you the maps. It certainly doesn't look like Gaussian or anything like that. They have like galactic structure and stuff like that. So what can we do with this? So at this point, I'll drag in a little bit more formulas so I can actually, like, you know, point more scientific things. So you know how these things emit in principle. Synchrotron you do for sure, and these things you also do, like dust grains. So you can write down integral along the line of sight. It's probably most convenient to do it in terms of optical depths. There's going to be some sort of, you know, spectral response how this is emitting. And then you just integrate it over with optical depths, over the optical depths of the variable at certain frequency. And then the only thing that comes in the emission is essentially orientation of the magnetic field in the grains. And this P0 parameter, which is called intrinsic polarization. But essentially, if you have a sub wavelength blob of something, you can integrate, like, you know, literally integrate it out, how it would emit as a black body radiator. And you can derive this formula. So one of the points which is sort of goes into making is that geometry of the field comes in two places. It is through the cosine square gamma. Gamma is the angle it the magnetic field makes with the plane of the sky. And it goes also in this psi angle, and that's orientation of the magnetic field on the plane of the sky. So you don't get to see amplitude of the magnetic field because you're essentially looking at the compass needle. It doesn't care about the amplitude of the field as long as it doesn't get knocked away from alignment. So, but you just get the orientations of these things. And another thing I want to pontificate that, like, you know, no matter what the source function is or where the column density is, it's common between intensity and polarization. So it might be advisable to take a look at the variables which factorize this common dependence. Column density is a hard one. I mean, like, the complicated one. That's where the dust is. So there might be cloud there, might be cloud there, might be cloud there. On the other hand, you sort of suspect that magnetic field might be simpler because it's around us, it's big, it doesn't like to bend too much. And perhaps taking a look at the just orientation of the thing would be a nice thing to do. Well, if you just didn't have an integral, like, you know, common factor is easy to get rid of. You divide one by another. And whatever that was, it goes away. So, and then you're just looking at essentially cosine square if you do that. So you're looking at an angle between, like, you know, P0 perpendicular angle between the magnetic field and the plane of the sky, or put it another way, perpendicular component of magnetic field divided by the magnetic field squared. All right. Well, that inspires you, and you sort of want to do, like, you know, let's do something that which factorize the dependence on column density, but yet keep the tensorial structure of the polarization as it is. So polarization is really a tensor. So if you want to keep that structure, perhaps you should operate with it as a tensor. And the simplest transform that does it is you just take a logarithm of the tensor as it is in two by, like, in two-dimensional sky, it's 2 by 2 matrix, has components of I plus Q, I minus Q on diagonal, U off diagonal. You take a logarithm of it. It's like, you know, basically the usual matrix logarithm, if you wish. And you end up with variables which are essentially, I'll call them small I's, Q and U's, are essentially polarization fraction variables. So I small is a logarithm of I, if polarization is small. And the Q small is Q. It looks like it's Q over P, but it's actually I plus P here over I minus P. So this guy is P over I when you expand it for small polarization. So you get Q over P times P over I. So it's just Q over I. So it's literally polarization fraction variables if you're not very highly polarized. This, of course, invertible, so you can write them down, like, you know, in going back and forth. But it's nonlinear, though. So let's take a look at the maps, like, when I do this. That will give you sort of, you know, an idea of how it goes. So you're looking at dust. So it's Planck 353. I smoothed it out to about 80 arc minutes to get rid of the noise. So there is literally, like, very little noise contribution in it. It's not as sort of speckly anymore because of that, but it also gets you an idea, and I plotted this one in logarithmic scale. So you have very bright emission in galactic plane. There is this arc up here in the northern thing. Here is this spur. You can clearly see it, and there is like this bright region here, which I don't know the name of. Oh yeah, and I cleaned this one up from point sources, so there is like not many, like, you know, bright points show up. Okay. So here what it is like. If you take a look at the polarization, well, Q and U maps are nice, but they're components of tensor, so they're not so easy to visualize. What people normally do, they rotate the basis, if you wish, into the scalar-like variables E and B. That's non-local transform, but people can do it. And that's how the E mode of polarization, the gradient pattern like, looks like for the dust channel. It's all heavily in galactic plane. You see, you don't see the spur, but you see this actual bright thing here. And it's highly correlated with the emission in intensity. So the same features are in there. And you can go for the B mode. This is the one that sort of masks you the gravitational waves in the thing. And you look at it, and it's also pretty galactic dominated. And there is lots of it off the galactic plane. Okay, so that looks like a complicated structure. And this guy looks like, you know, also correlated with the galaxy, but not so obvious with other features. Yes?
I have a question about, so for the scale and bottom, in terms of how much these are varying, this one is significantly smaller than the previous two, right? In terms of what the colors.
No, it's actually comparable. I mean, the B mode is a little bit less than E mode in color scale. This is after ranging, so it's all set by, like, you know, this bright spot over here. So as far as RMS of these things go, you get roughly twice as much amplitude of E mode than B mode in dust. I'll show you the spectra in a second, so that would be a little bit clearer. Okay, but let's take a look at this, you know, logarithmically transformed variables. Well, small I is, of course, logarithm of intensity, so you see exactly the same map. And small, you know, polarization of the small, like, you know, polarization fraction variables, now looks like this. So this is the E variable, which I made out of the polarization fraction variables. So the most obvious thing that, like, jumps at you right away, where is the galaxy? Galactic plane is gone. So there is no particular specific, like, you know, complicated looking thing where the galaxy is. So by the looks of it, just taking, like, you know, a ratio, totally got rid of all the complexity of galaxy, which looks like it's associated with a huge column density, which you have, but rather not particularly, like, you know, specific place as far as this polarization fraction variables goes. So that starts you thinking, okay, well, maybe you're looking at, you know, at thing which is actually sort of reasonably uniform around you. There is still structures in there. There is like big blob here, here, like bright arc, arc is now brighter because, like, you know, galaxy is gone. And there is like this big cross, whatever it is. So it is there, and you start thinking about it, but it looks quite a bit more isotropic than it used to. That's a good start. And you look at the B mode of that, and that's where the things become like looking quite actually interesting. You look at the B mode, and B mode starts looking like random. It is more red than CMB, but I could probably fake it and say this is like, you know, filtered CMB map. So it is actually looking like it's a Gaussian random field, and it's a Gaussian random field with fairly reddish spectrum. Okay. So what is happening? Actually, if you stare long enough on it, you'll see that near the galactic plane, I actually have a little bit less of fluctuations. It looks like the average away a little bit when I have a column density.
The scale in color of this one and the prior one, so we have 0.25.
Yeah, about the same factor of two.
If one does a, instead of an E, a little e, one does a little p, that's dominated by the e. Mm-hmm. So it more or less looks like the e.
It's actually, I will show it in a second. When I do the total polarization, small p, I like to normalize it to the largest value being equal to 1. So I essentially extract the common factor in front of it. But let me show you one more formula before I do that.
I just raised that mm-hmm. because little p is the eigenvalue.
Yes, indeed. And I'll show you the map of that. I like to have both maps for total polarization and for E and B splits because they're visually complementary. Okay, so here are the spectra. So if you look at II, it's of course, this is full sky, there is like no masking on it whatsoever. If you look at II, it's heavily dominant in power. And I had like, you know, cutoff, of course, because I filtered everything with 80 arc seconds. It's still there, but I fit for cutoff. So a lot of the spectra look like power loss. And here is my EE spectra, and here is my BB spectra for dust. So you can see they are sort of, you know, slightly different spectral indices, but, you know, close to two. And that spectral index depends on where you put the cut on the sky. So it actually steepens up if you go up to high latitude. And the ratio between these two things is sort of, you know, is also depends on where you are. But it's, you know, comparable in amplitude. What's interesting is there is huge correlation between intensity in E, you've seen this in the maps, and there is also correlation between intensity in B, which should not be there, because if it's like, you know, non-parity, like violating process, this thing has wrong parity to it, this should be zero. But of course, galaxy violates parity, there is like, you know, structure with this, and you're inside it. So like, you know, in theory, you shouldn't have it, but in practice you do. So here's what happens if you go to polarization fraction variables. Once again, full sky. Essentially, most of the correlation between I and B goes away, and correlation between I and E becomes much less. So essentially, you're looking at as if, like, you know, you randomized your variables, and you got rid of this nasty correlation that you had before.
What about the parity of EB correlations?
E and B is also parity violating, but it's so small that it's here is sort of dominated by the noise. You still see it, and it's like, you know, but once you go on full sky, you can kind of barely make it out. But once you go to the high latitude, the power is so low that it's, you know, got swamped by the noise. I cannot tell much about it. Okay, so the thinking is, because I'm looking at orientation of magnetic field, my cosine square gamma thing is just, you know, two components of magnetic field divided by the total component of magnetic field. This guy is corresponding components I can do like, you know, in spherical component tetrad or rather orthogonal, like, you know, three vectors in it. So I should be able to try to figure out what my magnetic field configuration is given if these guys. Because what I'm doing, I'm essentially looking at the weighted averages of these three components of magnetic field along the line of sight, and the weight is where the dust is. So I can even formally, like, you know, introduce a like averaging, weighted averaging, where my weight is all, you know, in my, like, you know, sits in my optical depth. Okay, so if you have really large scale structure of magnetic field, it probably doesn't matter where you sample it, as long as it doesn't change too much. And, but you expect, of course, magnetic field to be also has turbulent component because things like move around and they probably mix it up. When you look at these plots of stuff, you see that they're quite red. So it's actually like, you know, it's a lot of power is on the large scale. So you would suspect that when you try to fit the magnetic field, you'll end up with a lot of power being on the large scale as well. So let's do the simplest possible stupid thing. Replace magnetic field along the line of sight with a constant component and whatever else the perturbation of it is. And I'm going to assume this guy is smaller and expand in it. When I do linear expansion, I write down like, you know, a bunch of functional derivatives of these operators of projectors of magnetic field. And you notice very simple things that the linear, like, you know, the linear order terms in it essentially pick up the orientation of the constant component of magnetic field. And the rest of it I can cancel out by forming a polarization fraction variable. And the good thing, which is actually proxy for the Coulomb density of stuff and dust, is I plus P. Despite looking weird, it cancels out the linear and actually is proper Coulomb density for the dust up to second order in magnetic field expansion. Anyway, so once I have those things, I can basically do least square fit, where I would say, here's my polarization map. Let's try to get the magnetic field expanded into, let's say, multiples, make it rather smooth, and try to stuff it in. It's a least quadratic fit, which seems like a doable thing, except the functions here, Q and B, are all like rational. Therefore, they're nasty. Therefore, making it work required a lot of effort. But in the end, it worked. So here's the map that Dick wanted to see. This is the polarization fraction small p, and I normalize it so it's maximal to 1. And here's my fit, which I called by letter F, which has only L max 15 in there for magnetic field components. L max 15 is like this much on the sky, right? You know, remarkably, it fits all the large scale features, including this arc, which it has, like, you know, if you think about it, it's only a few degrees across. It's like you would say this is like not possible with, like, you know, resolution of L being 15. But it's because it's aligned with actual magnetic field structures. That's how this thing got resolved. So the fit looks ridiculously good. In fact, it looks so scary good that, you know, you would suspect it's actually not working for some reason. But no, it's actual real fit. And if you take it out, most of the power and large scale modes I've shown you on all these maps just go away. Before I do this, let me show you what it like magnetic field configuration around us is on the plane of the sky as you build up this feed by, you know, including more and more L modes. You start out with something which is the dipolar. Here's like, you know, your high latitude arcs which you've seen in, like, you know, in the smeared things, right? And then you start throwing in more and more, like, you know, details on it. That's like, you know, modes to L max equal 5. You start ending up with, like, you know, current tubes coming out of stuff, and it's like becoming like more severely. You increase a little bit resolution, that's L max equal 10. You end up a little bit more current tubes, like, you know, some sort of critical lines and stuff like that. And it gets more severely, like to maybe basically L max of 20. And here I just cropped out because you're fitting like basically 400 modes by the time you get L max equal 20. And it's sequential code, so I just ran out of patience for it to converge. But it's clear that it's all like, you know, sort of large scale structure is unaffected by this. Here's what's giving you the big high latitude arc. It's like just big span, like, you know, essentially from dipole field. And there is a little bit of, like, you know, swirliness on top of it. So this is like sort of, I call this the hair diagrams. Like, you know, it looks like, you know, you're looking at the head in various like states of disarray. here's what happens to the these large scale patterns. These are E and B modes. Now it's just simultaneously in the same, you know, identical scale. So here's a big blob in E. Here's like, you know, the counterpart of it. Here's almost random pattern in B. So all of it is essentially can be subtracted out from the fitted value of magnetic field pattern. Since I know the magnetic field, I know the corresponding polarization pattern with this. Let's just subtract it. Well, that's the pattern I get from the fit. And you can see already it's, you know, reproducing the features. I take one away from another, that's what left. Now, even like, you know, now if you even look at this one, you will be hard pressed not to see, like, you know, any features on it. There is this cross is still there. That's the only thing that I can pick by eye. I have a little bit different correlation lengths here because it's still noisy. There is basically noise showing up at the high latitude poles. But you look at the rest of it and you see, okay, well, this is actually looks like a Gaussian random field. And you can do like, you know, 1 point PDF. It is Gaussian with like 2% kurtosis. That's like, you know, like what 1 point, you know, looks like. If you look really close to it, the tails are slightly off. They're slightly, like, you know, they have kurtosis in. But, like, you know, this is ridiculously Gaussian. This is like technical term. This is supposed to be complicated astrophysical process. You know, the random magnetic field turbulence projected along the line of sight with variety of, like, you know, tracers. And you end up with a thing which is, you know, that random component of magnetic field looks like it's a Gaussian which is fairly uniform on the sky. You know, you can go after it with, like, you know, things like bispectra and whatnot, but it's clear, like, you know, it's loads more Gaussian than people thought before.
Can you go back to the picture for a
Which one? This one?
Yeah. Apart from the cross that you point to, the trouble is the eyes try and connect the dots.
Yes.
But you might get the impression there's a little bit of extra elongated anisotropies, but they're sort of random. In other words, how deeply has it been checked that it's close to a Gaussian field?
So not very deeply, because it's fairly new. I mean, the obvious thing, like, you know, it does seem like it's more elongated. So that probably will show up in bispectrum. In fact, you know that it was supposed to be elongated because a lot of the things elongate along the B mode. Right. So in fact, you can probably even take that structure in, because if you do it really long, or you have like lots of graduate students, you can go to second order. So second order will appear after you integrate out the spectra of this thing as contribution of the same sort of pattern as these guys. Right. So they will eat up probably associated power, which has, like, you know, stuff with elongation. So in some sense, this series would be, like, you know, continuing on, and you can resum all the even paths and all the odd paths. All the odd paths will give you Gaussian sort of random field statistically, and these guys will contribute to large scale pattern with, like, you know, all the spectra being integrated over. But anyway, that's not been done, but it might have to be done for synchrotron. So
from this distance, it still looks like the B map is slightly blurrier than the
E map. Yes, indeed. They have slightly different spectra, and they have slightly different distribution of stuff. So B map is slightly more Gaussian to my eyes.
Does anyone else really get it to, like, cross in your eyes to, like, spot the difference thing? I'm just curious if anyone else is trying.
Expecting to see a number come up.
Well, yeah, that actually might be a fun thing to try. These things are not correlated, so I don't think anything jumps out at you. Like, correlations would jump out of you if you offset a little bit. But these things are not really correlated by what I can tell, so I don't know what will jump out. Okay, so in fact, you can even eat up this couple percent of kurtosis by just saying, okay, well, I know this is supposed to be like point, like, non-linearity, so let me just renormalize it by, you know, taking not x realization of it, but x plus coefficient times x cube. And you can eat it up, and then it's like almost perfect Gaussian. So if you want to model it, you can do it. Well, there is obvious question of where you stop until you run out of computer power, and you can take a look at it as just how much of power from the big pattern you eat up versus how much you, like, you know, your estimators of non-Gaussianity are in one-point distribution versus amount of modes you actually ate up during the feed. So, you know, if you just do dipole, it's actually pretty good in taking up a lot of this power. But, like, you know, for non-Gaussianity to settle, you basically need to go to about L equal 10. And after that, it sort of, you know, gets better with a lot more expense. So I don't know, 20 I draw the line, it's like, it's okay. So, and it actually has a break in magnetic field configuration. There is a break in the fit until L equal to 10, it's more or less scale invariant in power spectrum, and then it just tanks, even if you throw more modes in. Yes? Vertical axis is dimensionless measure of variance, skew, and kurtosis. And for E modes and B modes. Anyway, this is basically supposed to be like, you know, the smaller, the better. So some sort of figure of merit, which I didn't compress to a single thing. All right. So modeling emission is simple then. because I now have a very simple model for it. My magnetic field structure is known around me, and then there is a little bit of fluctuation on top of it. The only thing I need to do is take this template, add to it a Gaussian random field in polarization fraction with known spectrum, and I can just exponentiate the entire thing back into, like, you know, my intensity variables and see if it agrees with the sky. So Tuhin Ghosh did this with even slightly simpler pattern than I've shown you to you. And that's basically, like, you know, if you do a fake sky, it fits the real sky pretty good. So this shows a statistical quantity known as S, which is the variance of an angle of polarization within the aperture as you run it on the sky. So that's one of the things people like to describe, you know, this this dusty polarization business. And you can also, you know, put this measure on like, you know, double distributions with the column density of H, which is like essentially the tracer for column density of dust, and the percent of polarization things. And I won't bore with the details, but essentially, like, you know, the sky correlations and random correlations, like, you know, in the random realization correlation, they essentially, like, you know, you cannot really tell them apart. So statistics come out good, fairly well, like, you know, and these are complicated ones. So at least for modeling, this thing is probably on the rails. You just have to, like, code it up, and then you can make, you know, fake dust distributions for polarization patterns. So the obvious question is, what do we do with synchrotron? And synchrotron is harder, and I am going to go really fast through it. So here's what the intensity map of the synchrotron looks like, and it's a component-separated one from Commander. So it has a bunch of cold spots as a holes in it. That's where, like, you know, they overfit a little bit for other things. At some point, I should patch them up. But here, what it is in E. So here's the story once again. That E component of polarization of synchrotron is highly galactic dominated. There is obvious point source sitting here. And here is this big spur. You can see it. It's big, it's bright, and it's there. And here's the big component of it, which is also there. And unfortunately, you cannot make out the spur very well, but it's there. So all these cross patterns you have is just basically this every point source, which has a cut in it, will create, like, you know, this cross pattern when you do this non-local transform. So don't pay attention to the small things, but I haven't fixed all of the, like, you know, problems in it yet. But let's take a look at what the polarization fraction tensor looks like if I take this. So let's take this. That's once again intensity-like structure. And here's what the polarization fraction on E mode looks like. And here you start realizing that it looks almost like, apart from a bunch of holes, almost identical to the stuff we had for dust. So once again, big blob here, big blob here. There's slightly different, like, sort of, you know, clustering properties of it, how it ramps up, but that's the same blob. For sure it's the same blob. Here's, like, you know, the spur continuing in. The arc is gone, by the way. There is no synchrotron tracers in there. And here's the B mode, and it also looks like, you know, like what we had before, with perhaps a little bit more excursion in a couple of places. And in fact, overall amplitude of this, you know, polarization is much bigger because polarization fraction of synchrotron is essentially one. So it's like very highly polarized. Now, okay, so it's almost the end of the story. The trouble with this is I don't understand where this pattern is coming from. It's clearly tracing the same structure as dust. But if you think about it, what it should be, being a series, well, you go to Rybicki book, which is like textbook on astrophysical things, and you, like, steal the formulas for, like, parallel component and perpendicular component of emission, and there is some special functions involved, and then you integrate it over with the distribution of electrons, which you think of the power law in gamma, with P being it, and you derive a great result that your polarization fraction is P plus 1 over P plus 7 over 3. So if P is constant, so if electron distribution is constant in the sky, this thing is constant. So what I am seeing in these pictures, it's clearly not constant. It's varying by a factor of a few. Can this really go and vary by a factor of like 3 on the sky? I don't know. That sounds pretty strange.
It's in supernova, you can test the probability gamma, you see the sort of linked theory that you go to. from relativistic geometry, when you expect this to change?
Yes. So that is partly, probably part of the story. Another thing I would worry about when I think about this, perhaps I have much more column density of actually synchrotron emission. So rather than having like, you know, one polarization orientation, I end up with averaging a bunch of them along the line of sight. So that will tend to decrease polarization ratio. And where there is lots of stuff, like, you know, it will decrease differently from where there is not lots of stuff. So when I do this, like, you know, magnetic field expansion thing, perhaps I should worry about averaging as well. So basically go to second order term. And they will not depend on exactly the same way, like on magnetic field, because you would have like, you know, regular magnetic field component and turbulent magnetic field component with different amplitudes. So they will not cancel to become, you know, a constant constant. So these two things I think should be done. First of all, you know, for me, I have to go and dig into a bunch of astrophysical literature about how much this variation of, you know, of electron distributions actually to expect, and like, you know, did I measure something interesting, or it was like known for like 70 years, or
another complication where if the size of the magnetic domains is smaller than the number you use, then you get a different kind of emission, jitter emission.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, with this one I might be safe because I'm talking about really large scale magnetic field. I mean, this is like half the sky size magnetic field. So if my Larmor radius is this big, maybe I'm not having a lot of emission. So maybe I won't see that break. I'm not 100% sure, but that would be my sort of gut reaction to this. This is pretty much like, you know, going to end up like on an open note because that's where we are right now. So it looks like, you know, the patterns you see in synchrotron trace very similar structures to what the dust is tracing. So it's got to be tracing the magnetic field once again. The question is now, can I build up a quantitative model of it and reconstruct a magnetic field now carrying information about the perpendicular component, including the value of magnetic field, because that's what the synchrotron is sampling, and how to like break down other degeneracy, perhaps roll infraday rotation, which is line of sight magnetic field information, which we do have on certain like line of sight directions. So that's the current state of it. Practicality wise, it looks like polarization fraction is where it's at as far as polarization goes, because first of all, it's frequency independent. So you actually are fitting it for the same channels, like, you know, in CMB experiment. And second of all, it's all large scale. Therefore, you can reconstruct it when you do the component separation with really high signal to noise. So it will be quite beneficial to sort of rewrite your component separation codes to use this as the variables in which your components separate. Because, like, you know, you get more of the prior, like, you know, data projected on these maps. And that's where the degrees of freedom, like physical degrees of freedom, live. So it's non-linear, but okay, well, fine. That's complication of life of so whoever is coding this up. But you know, that's how physics works by the looks of it. And so that's it. So for starters, these things should be useful for making the mock skies. And long term, I think like, basically I should just go and give it a whack for like new generation component separation code, which uses this correlation stuff. So that's it.
Recently, a few weeks ago, we had a talk by Clark.
Yes.
Susan Clark. Mm-hmm. Do you know about her work?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, well, I think she said in the context of her talk that the regions of low synchrotron polarization were also the regions where she was finding variations in magnetic orientation all along the site. So I think your question about can you cut down the polarization?
Yes, so that's very likely, yes, indeed. In fact, I sort of like when we were in New York a few weeks, it feels like a few years, but because I was doing my NSERC applications. But anyway, I ran into Brandon Hensley, like, you know, who was on papers with Susan Clark. So we had a nice chat, and it looked like we like converged independently on a lot of things. So they are doing what they are doing. doing is they're trying to reconstruct the dust polarization using H1 maps as tracer of it that only has intensity information, but high resolution one, and you also have velocity information on it. So what they go after, like, you know, to reconstruct polarization, they go after elongation of these maps, and they smash them down, like integrate them out, and they look something which looks like quite plausibly, like, you know, like emission things. So one of the things that pop out in their story is then they were doing for the column density tracers, and they come up with this observation as well independently, and they actually like test it, and it does work. So like, although it looks like a stupid variable to be using, it's actually is a pretty good tracer for dust column on the maps. And with synchrotron, this formula, of course, has to be like, you know, adjusted because different emission formulas, right? But yeah, I mean, like, it seems plausibly that, like, you know, the depolarization which came up with discussion, like, you know, with Hensley, that would be like one of the things that to knock it down in some regions. And I don't know, maybe you still need to have the spectral index variation and fit for it somehow. That might be interesting map to have, cross-correlated with other, you know, stuff, like radio loops. Yes. Power spectrum I didn't show because it's still preliminary, but I do have it on my computer. I can show it to you. But essentially, astrophysically, what it looks like, that, you know, I don't know the depth scale of it. I don't know how far it extends, but at least around me where there is a dust emission regions, I think I have a basically more or less constant large scale magnetic field pattern, which I know direction of. So I can multiply it with the amplitude function, which I don't know of. But with this, I have some sort of, you know, magnetic field configuration around me. And that's fairly hard to come by. Because, like, what else do we have? Well, we have Faraday rotation measure. It measures one component of it, and it's not as full sky as this. It is like big southern hole in that Faraday map, where there's like not so many line of sight informations. And if I couple this to synchrotron, maybe I can break degeneracy with magnetic field amplitude even. Who knows?
You're saying you have no distance information.
No, but I'm going after big, essentially constant component around me. So the model is that I sit in the center, and here's like magnetic configuration like on Earth attached to me. And then it does something like farther away, but I don't know what. So it's like literally like asking what the magnetic field of the Earth looks like.
You could couple this with flux work, then you get velocity information.
That would be possible. Mm-hmm. Yes?
So our interpretation of S going like 1 over P, picking up on presence of consciousness, P was getting small because of depolarization of multiple sheets or whatever along the line of sight, which had different characteristics or conditions. So is that the same underlying picture that it's coming from?
So for dust, I'm actually not quite sure about the amount of depolarization. So by the looks of it, I can get away with feeds which have almost zero depolarization in them, which is somewhat strange, but it seems to be working. There might be some depolarization. I see it on the maps, like visually in the galactic plane. See, you can probably not make it even. I can see it on computer, but it's not so well here. Here you have a little bit of less fluctuations, right? So visually I can sort of pick them up, but it's not factor of two, right? So it is subtle, and this is like the most column density I have. So there is, I don't know why, but there is indication that depolarization maybe is not order of one, at least in the dust magnetic field fits I have. So it's probably smaller than one. So it's not like dominant effect.
When you project this back into the other variable,
mm-hmm.
from which you can calculate S,
yep.
and P,
mm-hmm.
the whole range of values
of
T, and the interpretation in our view was that lower values of P was called depolarization.
Ah.
And it went along with larger values of S.
Right. I think it's actually most of that slow values of polarization is where magnetic field is just sticking out. So it's not depolarized. It's just, you know, rather than having, you basically have like hedgehog configuration. So most of these things where the polarization fraction is really low is magnetic field is just sort of along the line of sight. And there are a few places where it tilts along the magnetic field lines or becomes large, and that's where the polarization is large. So that's actually sort of different from, like, you know, how people thought about it before. So we're still debating this with François Boulanger, who also had thought that the depolarization is actually going to be substantially more than what I'm getting in the feeds. I am not sure. I would, like, you know, expect that it would be there, but it fits without it.
Can you test for L dependence in that? Because you might expect that the depolarization is smaller at low L than at higher L.
That is probably what is what's it, right?
Yeah, well, the question is, can you actually, does the data allow you to check that?
Right. So that is actually probably what is happening, because on the large scale structure, I don't even need it. But then I have very strong break where I'm keep fitting the modes, doing exactly the same thing, and they don't fit anymore. And that's about, like, you know, about L equal 10, the fit, like, you know, that just breaks out, right? So it looks like there is a physical break in the configuration of magnetic field. Anything with L equal 10-ish, it's like, you know, it's clearly seeable in this pattern. The rest of it is just like this turbulent thing, so they probably averaged away.
It's like multiple screens at higher L, and
yes,
more or less single screen at lower L.
Yes. So,
so that's actually, that's an interesting break to flesh out in L space if you can.
Indeed, yes. Well, since it comes to mind, I can just probably pull it out. Dust figures. This is secret, but not so secret that I cannot show it to you. Here is a magnetic field fits starting out, like, you know, with L max equal 5, which of course has zero power because I'm not fitting it. And that has a three eigen mode projection of magnetic field fit. So that's the total power of magnetic field in black. And I keep increasing, like, you know, stuff. Here is 10, here's 15, here's 20. So that's multiplied by LL plus 1. So flat is scale invariant around 10. Like, you know, even with the fit goes, it goes and goes dive down very steeply. So it's hard to tell because, like, you know, computationally, I might be not fitting the modes yet. Like, you know, I'm doing nonlinear fitter. It runs until I run out of patience. It might not have converged yet. So it might actually have not enough power in these things because it did not quite converge. On the other hand, it seems like, you know, the fit is not improving, and there is sort of, you know, fairly clear break at, like, you know, 8 or 7 or something like that.
You don't want us to treat this?
Hmm?
I said you don't want us to treat this.
Let's say this, like, I will claim plausible deniability. This was like the graph of, like, the course of the dollar of the next.
It's not, I think, like, sign up, right?